There's this great bridge you can jump off into the water, and I did that many times. And so anyway, I'm just really happy to be here. So it means a lot for me to be back here in Plainfield and have all you guys. So thank you.
I get to go to the thing this morning.
I'm just going to get started here. Let's see how it goes. I'll take questions afterwards, so if people have questions, feel free to even interrupt me if you like, but especially to discuss things deeper afterwards. So 20 years ago, almost to this day, I had this wild idea, and a bunch of friends and I got together, and we thought we would try to shut this place down. We were against what they were doing there, and what they were doing was vivisection, animal experimentation on cats. They would put these devices on their heads and drill them into their heads and wire them into their heads. And they would drop the cats over and over and over again and see how that affected their balance and see how different trauma affected the cat's balance. They just did the same experiment every year, over and over again. It was a dozen cats a year. They would get new students to come in and get funding, new funding every year. Just do it over and over again. And we thought that was kind of not cool. And so we thought we would try to actually shut this thing down. Taking the step beyond just actually saying I disagree with this and I want it to be known that I disagree with this into the step to where you're actually at a point of saying I'm going to do something to try to stop this physically. And we had voices in Portland, Oregon. Thank you. And we had voiced our opposition quite extensively. We had written letters to the editor. We had tried to set up meetings with the officials who were overseeing the bigger organization that this was done under, and we had started protesting and petitions, and we had gotten our protests rather large, so there were hundreds of people, and they got big news stories, but it just didn't seem to be having much of an influence. So we got this idea that we would go into the building where these things happen and just, you know, cause a ruckus. We would lock the whole place down, lock our arms into these things called lock boxes, these steel tubes, sit in a room and chant very loudly so that they couldn't really get any business done that day. And this is just an administrative lobby of the building where this was going on. Once we went, and I was among the people who went into the lobby and locked down and started chanting, there were other people who afterwards locked their necks to the front door so that no one could get in or out, and then went up to the roof and hung banners off the roof. And the news came, and it was pretty exciting. It was the first time I was ever really arrested. I've been arrested one other time before that at a UC Berkeley protest, and it was just campus police, and we didn't get taken to jail. We just got kicked off campus permanently, whatever. It wasn't a big deal. So it was the first time I was arrested by real police, thrown in a paddy wagon, and processed through the jails. So I was 18 years old in 1996, October 29th, when this happened. And it wasn't my first time protesting, but it was my first time getting arrested. You know, I was not completely inexperienced, but I was relatively inexperienced. I went on to do this a couple dozen more times and get somewhat of a lengthy, you know, criminal record of civil disobedience actions for whatever that's worth. And years later, when I would start using the Freedom of Information Act and getting documents from the government, I got this document, which is the police report from that very first time I was arrested when I was 18. And they listed all 11 of us, here's me, they listed all 11 of the people arrested that day as associated with the Animal Liberation Front. If you don't know, the Animal Liberation Front is an underground organization. They break the law, that's what they do. They don't have petitions. You can't join, you know, and pay yearly dues or anything like that. They are specifically a clandestine group that breaks into facilities where animals are being tortured or killed, steals the animals, burglarizes them, then releases them either in the wild or to caring homes, right? So the government considers them a terrorist organization, but you know, many animal liberation and animal rights activists consider them something between civil disobedience and revolution, a sabotage group, somebody who's taking direct action, they would say. But nonetheless, the government considers them a terrorist organization, and so they list all 11 of us as members of this terrorist organization, when in reality, I was one of the more experienced people among that group, and this was my first time getting arrested. I was 18 years old. And so thus begun a lifelong, so far, experience of, as an adult, of dealing with being associated in terms of, in the eyes of law enforcement, with terrorism because of my involvement in activism. And I can, you can look at this FBI file and get an idea of how they view it. Pickering has been active in the eco-terrorist arena dating back to 1997. It was targets of FBI investigations in the Portland division, and while serving as spokesperson for the press office, which I'll talk about in a minute, Pickering became a media target as well as a target of law enforcement. Pickering became the face of the ELF. This is me being the face of the ELF, and I'm going to have to explain that a little bit. The ELF is like the Animal Liberation Front that I mentioned, but they're the Earth Liberation Front, right? They came along in 1996, and they did a lot of the same type of things that the Animal Liberation Front did, but they did them for environmental causes. And they turned up the heat a little bit more than the ELF had ever done. In fact, they became the FBI's number one domestic terrorist priority. They engaged on a 5-year sabotage spree that amounted to the most extensive and expensive U.S. spree of sabotage in U.S. history. And they would do, well, within a 5-year period, they did 36 large-scale arsons targeting corporations and government agencies that were destroying the environment or polluting or engaging in genetic engineering, etc. And they would average, at their peak, about $2.5 million in damage each time, and they would do an action every other month or so at its peak. A lovely Eliza right now is passing out matchbooks, which are for novelty purposes only. They have Earth Liberation Front's first communique on them and an image of Vail Ski Resort on fire, which was a rather famous action that the Earth Liberation Front has done. So what I did was form a separate group. I naively thought that I could just exercise this thing called the Bill of Rights, or the First Amendment in particular, and exercise free speech and say, I agree with what they're doing. And I hope more people do it. And immediately things got hairy. What had happened was they had decided to send me and the people I was working with their first communique, which is a message from the underground explaining what they did and why, right? We burned down this facility because they're engaged, in that case it was the U.S. Forest Service because of logging. They did a $6 million arson in 1996 against the U.S. Forest Service because of logging of old-growth forests in the Pacific Northwest, in Oregon in particular. And if you're familiar with the Fall Creek tree sit, it was very connected to that particular campaign. So they would send a communique out, and it would be a paragraph or a couple paragraphs explaining what they did and why, and they'd send it to me. And then I would put it into a press release, send it out to the press, and then the media would come, as you see here, and they all were very interested. They really didn't care about talking about global warming, as they called it back then, you know, when nothing was burning down. But the moment a million-dollar building starts on fire, they're all of a sudden jumping over each other, sometimes literally, to get the news story. And I'd just like to point out that that's not the way that's not us deciding that. Like, our movement has tried to speak about these issues as peacefully as possible for many years, for a long time. And when you don't get attention, you have to make a decision sometimes. Am I going to continue doing this thing that doesn't get attention, or am I going to take a bigger risk to try to... This is an important issue. Protecting the environment and protecting the planet is an important issue. If we don't protect it, we'll all die, and the future for our children is not going to be good. So people in the movement that I was involved in were willing to take that risk and willing to develop skills, including criminal skills, to further that movement. And my role was to speak out. Yes?
Can you say a little more about how you found yourself in that role? I've always been curious.
Sure. I was always leaning towards being radical. You know, as a kid, I didn't know anything about politics. My family wasn't political, but I liked Robin Hood, and I liked the concept of people who stood up and fight back. By the time I was 16, I went to some concerts, like underground-type concerts with other friends, other misfits from school, and I got handed a zine, a little booklet, about the Animal Liberation Front, and I thought it was really cool. So from then on out, I just tried to hook up. I tried to find the underground elusive Animal Liberation Front. Never really did. I tried to find Earth First, which was not completely underground, but I still had a lot of trouble finding them. I was looking for a movement to be a part of. And so when I did find people who thought the way that I did, we didn't exactly go out and do sabotage, but when we did our civil disobedience, like that action I talked about, we would also take the opportunity to say, oh, and by the way, we think the Animal Liberation Front is great. Or, by the way, like the Weather Underground was a really inspiring organization for us. Or, by the way, the Underground Railroad. This is what we're doing for the animals right now is similar to what the Underground Railroad did for African Americans. So we always try to tie it back to the more radical elements of the movement. And I think that because we did so much civil disobedience and we spoke publicly quite a bit and published our own newsletters and stuff quite a bit, that we just became known as people who won. Were in support of radical activity, but two, had experience with media. And those two things combined, I think, is what led, you know, the Earth Liberation Front to just start sending the communiques to us. I mean, it kind of landed on my lap. It wasn't so, if it were up to me, I would have been wearing the ski mask, especially at that age, wearing the ski mask at night and going, starting things on fire, but that just wasn't how it happened for me. You know, what happened is that I got the communiques and I said, okay, I can do this or I can run and hide, and I decided to do it. That makes sense. And naturally, again, when buildings burn down, the media jump over each other to get attention about it, to get the top story. But they're not the only ones who pay close attention. And the Earth Liberation Front were very good at not getting caught. And so for many years, almost a full decade, almost nobody was caught for any of these actions, and they just kept doing more and more actions. The FBI and the other law enforcement agencies like the ATF, Oregon State Police or whatever, U.S. Marshals, whoever was investigating the moment, were getting very frustrated, right? Because not only have they not solved the first three ELF actions that happened in 1997, but they hadn't solved the next eight that happened in 1998, and they sure weren't about to solve the next 11 that happened in 1999, right? So it was getting frustrating. And their leads were ending up as dead ends, so they really started putting a lot of pressure on us. They also most likely viewed us as, and me in particular, as somebody who was able to spread this idea. The Earth Liberation Front is a decentralized sort of effort. It isn't something where there's a leader and all the other people follow a chain of command. Anyone could form their own cell and take action as long as they follow these guidelines. And so the more publicity you got about that, the more little cells are popping up here and there, spreading out from the Northwest across the country. and eventually into the Mexico and Moscow and the UK most recently. But they really wanted to shut us up. So they started all kinds of surveillance, and I'm just going to give a quick overview of that, because it'd be way too much to go into everything. These were the top investigations, you know, in the Northwest of terrorism at the time. Hundreds and hundreds of agents were assigned to them from various organizations. So they raided our homes on two occasions, two full-on joint terrorism task force raids. They subpoenaed us to federal grand juries on seven occasions. One time subpoenaed to a congressional subcommittee investigation, which I had never even heard of before that, and still don't know of any other circumstance when that even happened. And they were constantly harassing us, following us around. We knew several of the agents on a first-name basis, unfortunately. They would be behind us in line at the grocery store. They'd be sitting at tables across the room in restaurants. It was nonstop. And so there was a lot of intense pressure from the FBI in particular, and the ATF in particular, on us during that time period. And they made all kinds of threats that we would spend, that I would spend decades in prison, not just a short time, but decades. And these carefully worded threats of violence, where, you know, they would say something like, oh, this is probably going to happen if you keep doing this. Not that I'm going to do it, but it was carefully worded threats of violence to sort of scare us. And it was scary. But we didn't back out.
There's plenty of right-wing Aryan Nation types in the Pacific Northwest. Why do you think you were the number one terrorist group, so-called terrorist group there?
Well, I can talk in general about why the left is prioritized over the right. Yeah. Part of it is targeting. Part of it is because the right is more aligned with the way the government runs in terms of repression. But part of it is targeting. The right wing does target a couple government agencies, but tends to more broadly tends to target individuals. They don't like people of color. They don't like women. They don't like people of various genders, whatever. And so they sort of focus on individuals. The left focuses on also more so on government organizations, but also largely on corporations. They don't target individuals. They target people who are making money, right? And these corporations are the ones who are basically running the government through this revolving door policies that they have everywhere. So when you, the moral of the story is, when you target corporations, you're considered more dangerous than when you're targeting people. You can hang someone from a tree because of their skin color, or you can burn down an empty building that's owned by a corporation, and the person who burns down the empty building is the one who's going to be getting most repression. That's just historically the way it's been. Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit, and I know you're asking for questions later, about the different language in the way that you're characterized? In other words, I'm thinking historically about the government. When is the language radical revolutionaries, and then especially terrorists, and drawing on all of the Islamophobia and recent trends?
I think it's kind of a, when something is considered terrorism, is there's various reasons and situations when the government will push that line. But to generalize, they'll throw those nasty terms out when they really want to change public opinion about somebody, when they want people to shut their minds off about them and stop thinking critically about whether this is an important issue or not. They'll throw the boogeyman term out. Whether it's terrorism this decade or communism another decade or what have you, you know, that's when they start doing that. And if you look at these actions, I mean, this is the number one domestic terrorist group, the Earth Liberation Front at the time. Nobody was hurt. Not a single person was hurt. 36 large-scale arsons. Not only were people not hurt, but no animals were hurt. Like, they removed fish tanks from buildings. They removed guard dogs. Nobody was hurt, right? And so your definition of terrorism is interesting. And what I can say about that is, I think that they use terms like terrorism when they're scared, you know. And in general, when a bully starts bullying, it's because they're threatened. And so I think that the system felt threatened at that moment, not just by these radical groups that were burning things down, but also by the popular movements that were growing, that were doing large grassroots organizing. We saw a lot of positive movement in the environmental arena in the 90s, leading up to the WTO protests, and I think they were very threatened by things like that 1999 WTO protest in Seattle, because you see many people getting together, and they're not just saying, I'm against this, they're actually taking that step to saying I'm going to stop it. Yeah.
I think it's also important to point out that the terrorist labeling focused on environmental activists long predates 9/11 and all of that. There were a number of notorious right-wing operatives that, you know, first put that rhetoric out in the early to mid-90s.
Ron Arnold and Barry Clausen.
Exactly, and it kind of took
off. And they were funded by the companies that were being targeted by environmentalists. And they were funded through 501c3 nonprofit organizations that they set up so that these companies that were being targeted by environmentalists could make tax-deductible donations to form a PR engine that made environmentalists look bad. So it's a very complicated thing. I'm not going to go too much more into that. But what happened was, you can watch this film, If a Tree Falls, if you want to get the whole story or a lot of the story on the Earth Liberation Front. But you know, the movement collapsed, unfortunately, and people scattered. And I was looking to work, continue to work on radical stuff, but not just environmental stuff anymore. I wanted to work on social issues and connect different movements together. So I moved back to Buffalo and formed this group of people who started working on poverty issues in Buffalo. And a lot of that came out of my work here at Goddard. Actually, my undergraduate, my last year of my undergraduate degree focused on community organizing, and that's when all this work I'm about to talk about now started. So we did this community needs assessment survey, which was, again, instigated by Goddard advisors. And we walked around the city of Buffalo and asked people, what do you think is wrong with this city? And how do you think it can change? And if you don't know, Buffalo, you know, has been a poor city for many decades. And there's been a lack of work. And so people had a lot of reasons of what was wrong with Buffalo. Corruption, lack of job opportunities, poverty, crumbling streets. The list just went on and on. But they had very little to say, and we talked to hundreds of people. They had very little to say about what we could do to change it. There was just no knowledge or inspiration or hope about how other people have fought to change their circumstances in the past and had some success. There was little knowledge of it. There was no hope that it could ever be done. So we took that information and developed the platform that we started working on. And that was just an education platform. You know, here I am, this radical terrorist, you know, spokesperson, renowned. I had been on Rolling Stone 3 times and had been on national television dozens and dozens of times defending the Earth Liberation Front. But here I am holding these little events like this one here in community centers in poor neighborhoods in Buffalo, where we would talk about different movements, show films, and have discussions with the community about different movements that have fought in different ways and gained some ground, so that we could then have a discussion about what we can do in Buffalo. And that went on for 2 years. We would show these films and have these discussions and speakers, and we do it in 2 neighborhoods in Buffalo, the 2 poorest neighborhoods, our neighborhood in the west side, and then another neighborhood in the east side. And we'd have these discussions, people would talk, and we just kept doing it. It seemed like it was working. It was going to be slow. You know, it wasn't as sensational as burning down buildings, but it felt like it was worthwhile activity. And as you can see here, you know, these are some of the programs we have. This is about the American Indian Movement. That was about COINTELPRO, Malcolm X, the Young Lords Parties of Puerto Rican Independence Movement, Attica Prison Uprising, the MOVE organization. We just showed many films about different things and had these discussions. Relatively benign stuff, you would think. But not so according to the FBI. We got these files later, and we found out that the FBI sent undercover agents to these meetings and reported back. And this is one of the forms that from one of the report backs. And I'm just going to read some of it because it'll help us sort of stay on the same page. A Buffalo source, that's an informant, an undercover informant, attended a screening of a documentary about the Young Lords Party and their activities in New York City in 1969. Young Lords took over churches and hospitals in order to have their complaints, such as lack of proper sanitation and proper medical care in their community, heard. The theme of revolution was highlighted in the film. Also, the film stressed that although the Young Lords committed acts of violence, such as taking over the church, they also accomplished some good, such as feeding the children and the needy in the Puerto Rican community. The Young Lords also stole equipment from a Puerto Rican from a hospital used to administer tuberculosis tests and chest x-rays. Despite stealing the equipment, the Young Lords was able to administer the chest x-rays and the tests. Some members of the audience commented that the Young Lords weren't a bad idea after the filming. And there you go. Here I am. I was present at the event, but I was in the back of a room with an unknown female who's in the back of the room right now, running the projector. And I did not speak, but they thought that was still important to know. A male who identified himself as, and this is the person's name, spoke. After the film, these boxes are taken out by the FBI, if that makes sense. They're called redactions. This is the FBI's like, I'm not going to let you see this part. Right? So a male identified himself as so-and-so, spoke after the film. Several of the people there seemed to know him and called him by these other names. He appeared to be Puerto Rican with medium complexion, heavy Spanish accent, and in his early 30s. He wore work clothes, which appeared to have tar on them. It stated that he was just released from prison for killing an FBI agent, which isn't true, but I'm not going to go into that. It said it was either him or me, and I decided it would be him.
So they just made that up?
No, he said that this guy made it up. He exaggerated the situation.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Sort of a macho, you know, whatever nonsense. He exaggerated the situation. If he had killed an FBI agent, he wouldn't be out on the streets, but whatever. This is important here, this next part. He spoke about the former Northwest Public Library at 271 Grant Street in Buffalo. Let me see if I can show you a slide here.
Yeah, there it is.
What is this?
It's the address.
Well, the address is, so a lot of this stuff has happened. This one here. This one here is about a county budget crisis that happened in Erie County in New York. And basically, the county was saying, oh, we're so broke, we're going to have to close down a third of the public libraries. 19 public libraries are closing, and so a bunch of us organized to try to stop that. Failed, and they did close all 19 of those libraries. And so he's talking about that issue, which is an issue that was hot in the community at the time. Nobody wanted these libraries shut down, especially in the poor neighborhoods. He said it was their spot and stated that they were going to get the location back. He said, you don't have to go in the front door to get what you want. I'm going to go through the back door, talk to the janitors and the guy who cleans the toilets to find out what I need to know. There was an unknown male standing next to him, stated that the government tries to send crabs into the organization to find out what they do. Then classified that crabs were street snitches. He spoke in an aggressive manner. It goes on, it basically reports on the whole night. It goes on saying that a female, last name unknown, spoke at the beginning and the end of the film, in the evening. And she greeted everyone at the beginning and told everyone about the pamphlets, cookies, and books for sale in the back of the room. And at the end of the night, she said that ERISA, which was the organization that we were organizing under at the time, is an organization which wants to take back what is rightfully there. She announced another meeting on Sunday and Monday, December 18th and 19th, at the same times and locations. Announced topic for the next meetings would be Malcolm X. The female, last name unknown, and an unknown male appeared to be under the influence of drugs or alcohol. Stated that ERISA needed money to make pamphlets. They also said if anyone knew of any other locations to have meetings. I'd like to point out the thing about drugs and alcohol because it's totally not true. And if whoever that agent was sitting in the room now, they would probably say that we're all under the influence of drugs and alcohol. It's just this like really skewed perspective that you see from a lot of FBI agents in these types of reports. They're just, their world is on some other universe as far as I could tell. The point being that this is a super benign educational effort that is flying way under the radar. We're not getting news stories about it. We're not trying to get public exposure about it. We're going into poor communities, having meetings, showing films, and having discussions. And it's going on for 2 years, but it's a big priority of the FBI. And what ends up happening is that one day, the organization, the nonprofit community group called MAP, Massachusetts Avenue Project, that we were showing films in our own neighborhood in the West Side, got burnt down by neighborhood kids. They had broken in, messed around, and accidentally burned the place down. So MAP was without a home. They were funded largely by the city, town and council, by the city of Buffalo. And so, coincidentally, they had just closed 19 libraries, including one in our community, the one that this guy was just talking about on the last slide. And so the council member said, you know what, why don't you move into the old library? We've got a building, it's perfectly good. Why don't you just move your organization in there? We'll let you have it for $1 a year, and utilities included. And so they said, yeah, great. But the thing was, MAP didn't run a community center, so to speak. It kind of just needed an administrative office and a place for them to store garden tools. They did a lot of gardening and stuff like that. So there was this whole library, as you can see in this picture, filled with books that was just locked, the community was locked out of. They also had computers that the community was locked out of. And so MAP, having worked with us for 2 years and having a great relationship with us and seeing all the people we had working with us and how much volunteer labor we had, came to us and said, would you guys be able to reopen the public library? We said, sure, we'll give it a shot. But we had never made a public announcement about it. We never got to the point where it was going to be opened up yet. And all of a sudden, this news reporter, Sandra Tan from the Buffalo News, which is a big newspaper out there, got a hold of me and said, hey, I'm going to do a news story about how a terrorist is reopening the public library. And I said, I don't think I want to do that news story. I don't think I want to interview for that news story. We haven't been getting news for any of the stuff that we do. I'm not trying to get press in this project. She's like, well, I'm going to do it anyway. And if you don't cooperate, you know, this could influence the Massachusetts Avenue Project in a negative way because they're getting funded by the city. And it's going to look as though, you know, they're working with terrorists too. So we ended up doing the interview, trying to deal with it as damage control, but it was a clear piece of red baiting, if that makes sense. You know, they're coming in with an idea that this is a bad situation, and they're going to make everyone the story. It's not an open investigation. They're not unbiased. They're going in with the idea that they're going to do a story about how a terrorist is reopening public library, never mind the validity of the terrorist assertion whatsoever. She shows up with a big manila envelope filled with printouts of I don't know what on me, drops it down on the desk and starts rattling off all this stuff, and it was pretty clear from the beginning that it was, you know, it was red baiting. But we went through with it, and then the news article eventually came out after some haggling, and the Massachusetts Avenue Project disavowed its association with us in the paper, which we agreed with because we wanted to make sure they kept their funding up. But it kind of was the final nail in the coffin of this organizational effort, right? We also got kicked out of the other community center we were working with at the East Side right around the same time, and it just shut us down, and it made us realize, hey, maybe organizing big discussion groups about the need for revolution in city-funded buildings isn't a good idea. So we spent the next, you know, number of years getting our own space, which ended up being Burning Books, which is our radical bookstore in Buffalo, and now we do tons of events, like way more now than we did back then, like that, but in our own building that we can't get kicked out of as easily. The thing was, I was always suspicious about Sandra Tan and her motives, the journalist. I was always like, how does she even hear about this? All we have is one little listserv that the only way you get on that listserv is by showing up to our meetings and signing the sign-up sheet in the back. And there was only one little mention. The only thing we mentioned on that listserv was, hey, if you have any radical books, donate them. We've got a project coming up. That's all that was said ever about this whole thing. And all of a sudden, she's got all this inside information about not just what we're doing, but about me personally. And so I was always suspicious. Wouldn't that be the FBI, the same FBI that had been raiding me, the same FBI that had been subpoenaing to grand juries and all this other stuff for so many years? I don't have any evidence, so I can't really go to the public and say, this is the FBI, without looking like I'm wearing a tinfoil hat. So I kind of just keep it in the back of my mind, but I'm definitely suspicious. And just a second, when we later get FBI files on it, it starts to look even more so like the case. As you can see here, this is a clipping from an FBI narrative. The FBI are writing all paragraphs and paragraphs about the investigation into ERISA, into our organizing. Is this first paragraph here is the FBI agent's own words. ERISA has been the topic of some controversy in the Buffalo area, an article entitled blah, 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 dated blah, 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 reads as followed, and then boom, the whole article, word for word, letter for letter, is right in the narrative, and then after this, you see the agent just keeps typing his own narrative. Every other FBI file that I've ever seen that has an article in it has it either photocopied or printed out from the internet as, like, supportive matter in a separate file. They never had the exact text, like, right in the FBI's narrative, if that makes sense, right? So what that means is this person either sat there and typed every single letter after reading it, you know, transcribed it themselves, or else were supplied a copy, of a digital copy of the article somehow, right? So it's very suspicious. The weekly paper did a story about it, where they pointed out not just that, but they actually called Sandra Tan up, the old journalist, and said, how did you hear about this? and she pulled the like Reagan defense, you know, the sort of like, I do not recall, I don't remember, I can't comment on whether or not the FBI supplied me any information or not at this for this story. So it's very suspicious. Do you have a question?
I don't understand the problem because it's all like good what you're doing. You're not hurting anyone, and it seems like in this country we should be able to talk in that way about everything we need to talk about. And it's not hurting anybody. I don't understand this.
I agree.
Being a problem.
I agree. I wholeheartedly agree. I don't know what else to say about that except that I agree. The Massachusetts Avenue Project was kind of the de facto home for all of this community organizing, much of it not very radical, but definitely the stuff that relating to the county budget crisis and the library shutting down. And so there were all these other meetings in there, and they would have these potluck dinners, community co-op dinners they called them, where people who were interested in improving the community would come together, just share a meal, have informal conversations, you know, once a week. I think it was once a week. It might have been once a month. I can't remember. It was a while ago. But this woman, Amy Upham, was one of the people who would occasionally be at that meeting. I never really got to know her very well at that time, but she was somebody, you know, an associate, somebody I recognized around the community. Right? While we were still rehabbing the building that we got to turn into Burning Books, it has apartments in it. So we had to rehab the apartments first, then we'd start getting some income, and then moved to rehabbing the bookstore. And we just finished rehabbing the first apartment, and we were going out to lunch. And it's Nate Buckley, who's a co-owner of Burning Books, and me going out to lunch after working, after I think it was putting some flooring in. And we went out to this sort of place for lunch that a lot of people go in town, and Amy Upham is there. And she's sitting there with another woman who I never had met before, named Selena Lloyd. And they're looking at apartments for rent in the newspaper, and we had just finished, you know, this apartment. We're looking for somebody to rent, and hey, they're friends of friends, and Amy gives me a weird feeling. I get a weird vibe from Amy, but, you know, I'm so paranoid. I need to just chill out and just, like, you know, we'll rent these people. I make the mistake of renting these people. What we're looking at here is a CHS reporting document. CHS stands for Confidential Human Source. FBI got all these terms. And CS is another term, confidential source, but that can be like your telephone company. It's not human, right? It can be like a police department. It's not human. But this is an informant or a snitch, right, so to speak. And you really need to sort of dissect what's going on here to get a picture. And they do that on purpose. They make it hard to decipher. You see here, this is the date, January 26th of 2012, and the interaction is in person. So they're sitting, FBI agents and informants are sitting together in person, right? And this is really important. List all present. So this is being filled out by the FBI agent. And it says, list all present, including yourself. Do not include the CHS, because they're trying to protect the identity of the informant, right? So they list special agent so-and-so, another special agent so-and-so, the CHS that they do not include, and another potential CHS. So what that tells me is there's two people there informing. One of them has a history of informing because they're already considered a CHS. The other one, this is their first time, so they're a potential CHS. That makes sense? And what they said to the FBI looks like this. You've got redactions on top of redactions. These here are exemptions under the Freedom of Information Act, right? So whatever's here, or maybe whatever's here, is redacted for three reasons, right? National security protection, protecting the identity of a confidential source, of an informant, et cetera, et cetera. That's how they hide things from you. But whatever they said caused the FBI to open this case on February 1st of 2012. Based on information provided by an informant indicating that I am recruiting for an eco-terrorist cell. On this date, the informants provided the FBI with information regarding Pickering's potential involvement in recruiting for and forming an eco-terrorist cell in the Buffalo area. Pickering currently co-owns an anarchist bookstore called Burning Books with his longtime associate and co-owner Nate Buckley. They didn't mention Teresa. I don't know why. According to the informant, Pickering speaks at movie events hosted in Burning Books, and he often advocates for the use of violence as an activism tactic. He refers to using violence as adding more tools to the toolkit. According to Pickering, activists should be willing to use all of their tools, including violence, and those who are not willing to commit violence should support those who are willing. The bookstore frequently shows movies that depict violent uprisings. Before and after these movies, Pickering hosts talks that focus on how people feel about violence. And the informants characterized me as a masterpiece sociopath. Of course, you need to understand that this is how the FBI sees things. They would say the same thing about what I just said here tonight, that I'm advocating violence, that I'm saying that if you're not going to engage in violence, you need to give money to people who are engaging in violence. It's something which is not what I do, not what I've ever done, and not what I believe. But if you're looking at it through the lens of an FBI agent, it seems pretty accurate that way, apparently. So they took six people who were alleged associates of ours, and they added the three people who run the bookstore, and they came up with this nine-person eco-terrorist cell. Right? What that cell was going to do, totally unknown. They never even made allegations of that. Right? So there's not even a crime here to talk about. But that's what this whole investigation is based on. They took each of us, and they sort of compiled just everything that they had through their databases and through their connected sort of joint terrorism task force associated databases that they work with, and just put, you know, did these personality profiles, criminal histories, whatever they can think of on all of us. And this is what the six other people's pages look like. If they won't let us see them, we still have no idea who those six people are. Six people who were being investigated for terrorism for 2 years, by the way. You know, it's not just like, they wouldn't tell us who they were. These are people who could have gone to prison in this day and age for quite a long time for something that the government considers its number one priority. And they just won't even though the investigation is closed now, they won't even be out with who they're investigating. And they initiated, they start off slow, right? They initiated something called spot check surveillance. So if you're under investigation, these details might be helpful at some point. Spot check surveillance is when the FBI pulls up, parks, hangs out for a minute, takes some notes, and then drives away. Here they pull up in front of our house and parked in the driveway. It was one red Subaru station wagon. And they pulled up in front of the bookstore, and parked in front of the bookstore was Nate Buckley's truck. Right? Here's another one. They came on another time, and they parked in front of the house, and in the driveway was a roll-off dumpster. It appears to be that the house is under renovations, and the roll-off dumpster is for construction materials. Don't know how much money they put into figuring that information out, but it wasn't cheap. Next thing that they did was start digging through old FBI files that I had and looking for people that might not like me and calling them up. So they called up an old friend of mine, and this is that person's version of the phone call, right? I told them we were always there, that's Buffalo, for family and nothing else. They mentioned actions in Pennsylvania, those are ELF actions in Pennsylvania, in the 90s, but I don't know anything about those. And we were mostly only there in the summers. Some of their info was wrong or just messed up, and I'm wondering if they're just opening up new stuff and trying to find things about you as they say you are stirring up the youth. And they don't like that much. They wanted any names of people you might know, specifically who don't seem to like you much. If you think about that, they don't want to talk to people who, you know, sympathize with you or who are neutral. They're looking for people who can help them achieving their goal, which is making you look bad and throwing you in prison, right? They mostly talked about what I thought of you as a person and what I thought you were capable of. If you were influential, can you manipulate people? Are you a loner? Are you extreme? Yeah, it seemed to be mostly about personality stuff, but I tried to make it clear that we're not friends anymore, that I really don't know you or what you do now. I think they're digging up your past to try to figure out what they could expect from you today. So I guess who knows? If it happens again, I'll let you know. Right? So that's this old friend of mine's interpretation of what happened. This is what the FBI wrote down. And again, this shows the lens of the FBI and how they view all of us in our movement. Right? Leslie liked the attention as spokesperson. He played the part of being in the public eye. He became full of himself, idealistic. He comes across as aloof. He's arrogant. Could see how people don't like him. He alienated himself. Not a wannabe. I do like that part. He liked to say he was doing the right thing, had his own moral code, didn't smoke or drink, was vegan, kind of like his own religion. Believes in whatever. Inflexible. You know, so as you can see, everything here is just all about personality profiling. It's like you're trying to solve a puzzle in how you can break it, right? If you have an enemy, you figure out their weaknesses, and then how you can attack them.
You're not drinking, you have your own religion. It's very funny.
Yeah, the religion of not drinking.
It's ridiculous.
The next thing they did was start a U.S. U.S. Postal Service mail cover. Mail covers are something that have been going on for well over a century, where a law enforcement agency gets the post office to photocopy your mail before it's delivered. Not the inside, so they say, just the outside, but then they send copies of that mail back to the law enforcement agency. There's an application they go through. Post office, the postmasters almost never deny these applications. They go for 30 days. What happened here was they made this memo because there was a substitute delivery person that day delivering our mail, and they put this on the back of a piece of cardstock, post office cardstock, and left it on a stack of our mail in the back room of the post office. And when the substitute person came, they just said, oh, didn't even read it or whatever, mixed it up in our mail, got to our mailbox and just dumped it right in my, hand-delivered a top-secret memo to me in my house, right? That was my home address. It says mail watch across the top. It's a 30-day period, which is what all mail covers go for. And here, show all mail to supervisor for copying prior to going down the street, confidential, right? So that tipped us off to the fact that there was a mail cover, and we used the Freedom of Information Act to get copies of everything that they had copied, right? So here's copies of my mail. This is correspondence with the Tombstone Engraving Company as I was dealing with the burial of my grandfather at the time. Here is a postcard from my stepdad, a student loan bill from going here to Goddard. Here's a Amazon.com delivery. This is a nursing home correspondence for another relative that was in a nursing home at the time. This is funny. I was using the Freedom of Information Act to get files on this guy, Sam Melville. Who I wrote my graduate thesis on here at Goddard, and so I was corresponding with the Justice Department through FOIA to get that. The FBI sends letters to me and then has the post office copy those letters to send right back to the FBI. Right, it's just craziness. Here's our water bill. Here is a cool one too. My attorney, who's also the Freedom of Information Act attorney for Leonard Peltier and has done this kind of stuff a long time, he's. When we got that memo, it was still active, right? That 30-day period, it was like right in the middle of that 30-day period is where we were. So we knew that there was another week or two where this mail cover was going to be going on. He says, I'm going to run to the post office right now, drop a letter in the mail to you, and stamp on it legal mail. Because if they tamper with legal mail, it's an additional violation, right? So he did that, and there it was, right? When we got the files back, it worked, right? The next thing they did is something that people hear about a lot, don't know enough about, called federal grand jury subpoenas. I'd mentioned them earlier, and most of the time when people talk about federal grand jury subpoenas, they're talking about subpoenas to testify, where they drag people into court and force them to answer questions. Those are the kind that we hear about. If you don't answer, if it happens to you and you don't answer questions about your fellow activists, you can be held in contempt of court for up to 18 months, and it's not even a criminal charge, so you don't get a trial for it. You're not allowed to have a You're not allowed to have an attorney present. You're not allowed to remain silent. You don't have your Fifth Amendment right to remain silent. So it's a complicated thing. I'm not going to go into it too much unless you want to in a question and answer period. But as you see here, this is a subpoena. It says subpoena for, and these are 13 different subpoenas that we had, person or documents. Every one of the ones that we got is for documents. The kind I was just talking about where a person has to answer questions, that's that kind there, person. So what that means is they're contacting our phone company, getting all of our telephone records. They're contacting our utility companies, getting all of our utility records. Contacting the bank, and that's the one that we know about for sure, getting all of our information on all of our accounts going back to the beginning of when we opened the bookstore. So anywhere we swiped a credit card, they know when, where we were, right? Just through federal grand jury subpoenas like this. The next thing they did was put me on the selectee list. If you're ever flying on an airplane and you see four S's on your ticket, that's because you're on the secondary security screening selection list, better known as the selectee list. Right? That means that it's like the do not fly list, but they let you fly, except they pull you aside they make it seem as though it's random, but they run you through every single security measure that they have. They chemical swab test you, you know, they go open up your luggage, go through it. And they always say, well, it's just a random check. But if you look on your ticket and you have those lists on there, you know that that one actually isn't random, that you're on the selected list. They found out that we found out about the mail cover. Which probably wasn't too hard to do because we made a poster for it with it right on the cover because we were leading up how to use the Freedom of Information Act clinic, right? We put it right on the poster. So they saw this poster and they found out that we were... That we had found out about the mail cover, and so the FBI contacts the post office and gets all mad and like chastises the post office for screwing up, right? And then they put this whole big file in here about all, you know, all this. They tear a poster off a pole, include it in the FBI file and everything else. Then they start sending FBI agents to events like this. All the events that are happening at the bookstore, they're sending FBI agents to, right? CHS informant tasked to attend a lecture at Burning Books. CHS reports possible election fraud and violent themes at Burning Books, which is weird. Violent themes I get, but the election fraud, we never talk about elections there. It's just weird. Burning Books is anti-drone. Yeah, we held an anti-drone event. Like, how much rocket science do you need to figure out that we're anti-drone? The whole event was against the drone base that's in New York near us. So anyway, you know, they're sending people to sit in at Burning Books events and then reporting back to the FBI, like, what's going on? What is the possible any possible violations, election fraud, anything going on at all? It's just a broad brush. They're not even looking to see if this whole eco-terrorism allegation is true. It's just, can you find anything illegal at all? One thing that they thought was interesting was this event called The Failure of Nonviolence. There's a book called that by author Peter Gelderloos. It's you know, it deals with the question of violence, the never-ending question of violence versus nonviolence. But the FBI, of course, because of the title of that film, that book, came out and thought it was a very important event to send an informant to and report back on. And because of that, they printed out all this Facebook event page information. Everyone who commented on the Facebook event page for that event is now in an FBI file. All these people here and more. Then, as if all this stuff wasn't enough, they decided that they would follow us around. And this is how it works. They've got 7 FBI agents all working together on an 8-hour shift on this one day. They start off at our house. 6:52 a.m. I leave on my bike to work. A couple of them follow me to work, hang out in the parking lot at work until I come out for lunch, follow us to lunch, follow me back to work, hang out in the parking lot again until they get out of work and then follow me home. A couple of them go and hang out in front of Burning Books all day and make notes about what goes on there. And a couple more will follow Teresa and Eliza around as they go to the food co-op and any other sort of errands that they might be running that day. And they all report back to a central agent who's moment by moment putting things down in order about what we're all doing. And by the way, they're also following Nate Buckley, the other owner of Burning Books, around as well. So
do you ever confront any of these characters?
I'll mention that in a moment. So here's one particular day that's kind of interesting, right? They follow me to work. Somebody they believe to be me exited the building wearing on a bike and a backpack. 4 white males exit the parking lot on bikes, with a bike. There's only one bike in reality. And then they identify as I'm one of these 4 people that's leaving the parking lot. And then photos are taken, and subject is observing taking photos. This is me, I'm subject. I'm taking photos on Main Street by something. 3 individuals, including the subject, on Main and Chippewa, this is in downtown Buffalo, taking photos. These are FBI surveillance photos of us walking around. What's going on? You'll see I'm the one here in the t-shirt, and these other guys are all dressed up because they work for the Transit Authority of the city of Buffalo. Right, they run the buses, and I'm working for a nonprofit organization at the time that's running a campaign to advocate so that people can take a combination of riding your bike and riding the public transit to work. So we're taking some photos as sort of prototypes for a billboard that's going to go up where someone's getting on the bus with a bike, smiling, you know, saying, hey, look at me, I didn't drive to work, I rode my bike and took public transit. Very terroristic activity.
FBI.
Exactly. Very terroristic activity, right? So you got these three guys here, and then there's a bicycle wheel that pops out from the end of this trash can at the moment, which is our prop. I'm the one who's taking pictures, and they're following us around taking pictures of us, right? This is the one time that I can talk about briefly that, to answer your question. Right around this moment when these photos are taken, here I am, you know, with all of my activist history, and these guys are, you know, they're kind of in the nonprofit world trying to do good things for the community, but they're not activists, capital A activists, you know what I mean? They work for the transit authority, right? I see this guy like a block and a half away with this huge telephoto lens. And of course, my paranoid mind from my experiences leads me to think that's the FBI. Right? At this point, I had already gotten word of the phone call to my old friend. I had already found out that they left this thing in my mailbox. They're photocopying my mail. I found out I was on the selectee list. I had heard that they had grand jury subpoenaed our bank records. So I see this guy with the camera, and I'm thinking to myself, that's the FBI. Oh, God. Here I am with three guys from work that totally don't have any experience in this type of stuff. And we're walking right up to this FBI agent, like, what are we going to do, you know? I'm like, what do I do? Do I pretend like I don't know him just to play it cool to try to, like, not have a situation that might lose me my job? Or do I confront the guy because I really feel like I need to confront this guy who's obviously taking pictures of us? But by the time we get within a half block of him, he takes off. And I think afterwards, I'm like, oh, okay, you know, I'm probably just paranoid until I get these files, and here's the photographs. Here's another day. LP, that's me, Lisa Pickering, Teresa Baker in the back, and a blonde child approximately 2 years old in the back at this moment, approximately 7 years old, exited the vehicle and entered the Home Depot store. That's where the actual crime took place. We went window shopping at Home Depot this day. We were observed looking at garden hoses and light fixtures, right? Observed looking at flooring. And then we exited the Home Depot, and these are pictures. Miss Teresa is standing by the car. I'm walking up. If you look closely at some point around here, you'll see Eliza's arm and hand, and even her foot hanging out the door there for a moment. Oh, there's a little hand right there. I'm always amazed at how they've got this incredible skill to make anybody look like a fugitive, no matter what you're doing. And these types of photographs. Wegmans is a grocery store in our area. We arrived at the grocery store on this day, entered the store, photos were taken. Again, here I am at our car. Teresa's foot, it's a hot summer day, she's got her foot hanging out with her little toes there, and I'm handing in the car a gallon of water and a bag of bagels. We're about to go swimming in a creek at the family land about a half hour outside of Buffalo. Yeah, we are taking our pictures. So that kind of stuff does happen, you know. It's not just your own paranoid delusions that they're following you around taking pictures. Sometimes they actually are, right? Maybe more times than we like to imagine. A year into this two-year investigation, Upham, the informant whose photos I showed earlier, had broken up. The relationship had gone bad with Upham and Lloyd, and they had split up, and Upham had decided that she would repent, recant, as the FBI calls it. We called up the FBI and said, you know what? All that stuff I said about these people being terrorists isn't exactly true, right? And I want it on the record that I am recanting this, what I initially said. I still think that burning books is no good, and that I don't trust Pickering, right? But, in general, these people are all harmless armchair theorists and peace activists with big hearts who are trying to do right. Right? Nevertheless, FBI continues to investigate for a whole other year, right, before they finally close the investigation. We are able to, even though they have all their names blocked out in the files, we're very easily able to figure out that this is Upham and Lloyd through the context clues of the situation. They had informed on other stuff in these files, and if you looked at what they had informed on, they're the exact same other things that they had also gotten involved in and caused tons of drama around. Occupy Buffalo, a pirate radio station that was going on in Buffalo, and this squad And so these people, Upham and Lloyd, were known at, like, because of their involvement in those three things, that they had gotten involved in those three things, caused tons of turmoil, and then ditched out.
What was their motive? Were they being paid for this information?
We'll kind of get to that in a minute, maybe, a little bit, as much as I can. And so what we did was we got a bunch of people in the room that we knew had experiences with them, in particular those things that they were also informing on in these documents. We didn't tell them who we thought these people were, and we got our lawyers there too, and they sat down and we handed them copies of the document, those particular pages. And everyone came to the same conclusion. At that point, we felt very comfortable. Without any prompting of who we thought they were, they all said, oh, this is Amy Upham and Selena Lloyd. Right? So we felt very comfortable at that point talking to an investigative journalist with The Guardian and another one with The New York Times. And they reached out to Upham and Lloyd. And Upham immediately admitted her involvement in it. And gave quotes to these journalists about what she did and why she did it. And so that's how we were able to out these people. Here's an example of one of the articles that outed them. You start to see some other stuff mixed in with these documents too, right? You start to get an idea of what they're doing and why, how they think, how they operate in terms of the government, the FBI. Here's one little snippet that we always thought was interesting. Pickering has a strong presence on the internet in various forms such as YouTube, Twitter, Facebook, and several other websites to include. Leslie James Pickering in his .com, if anyone is interested, not .net. They screw up constantly in these files. Pickering also contributes to several Buffalo area newspapers, including New York Voice, and various media outlets Pickering can use. It may become difficult to keep track up to date and track of the various articles and videos and postings. They're finding it a pain that I'm getting out there, getting exposure as an activist through various different ways. And that type of exposure was a major, major ally in this effort that we have. We constantly got as much and continue to get as much public exposure as we can, front page New York Times articles, front page Buffalo News articles, NBC Nightly News interviews, small radio interviews like we just did here at WGDR the other day, nice. As much as we can all the time, and the FBI hates that, right? They want everything they're doing to be completely top secret and not to get exposed at all. And so, as you can see, like some of these things are clearly, very clearly in support of us. I sue the FBI for data. A bookstore owner turns tables. Pickering versus the USA. That was because of this first article that was the USA versus Leslie Pickering. They did a follow article where they're like, he's turning the tables. You know, so a lot of these articles are surprisingly supportive, even though that they all know that I have this past of supporting, you know, and continue to support radical activity. They're still saying, well, it's free speech is being violated by the FBI. And the FBI don't like that. So that's an important thing to take note of. This is interesting because the combination of getting public exposure and filing federal lawsuits against the FBI, which we've done two of and about to do our third right now, caused them to shut this investigation down. This is investigation 266I-BF41723. It lasted 2 years and it is now officially closed. The Buffalo CDC, that's Chief Division Counsel, that's the attorney for the Justice Department in Buffalo, concurs with the closure of the captioned investigation. No potential criminal violations of priority threats to national security warranting further investigation were identified, and they did this, why? To ensure preservation of the subject's civil liberties. Hmm. After 2 years, they thought it might be a good time to preserve our civil liberties after we get front page New York Times articles, after we file two federal lawsuits against them. Now they want to preserve our civil liberties, right? Pickering has been the subject of investigations and or associated with predicated subjects for over 10 years. Pickering espouses radical views on the use of force to achieve social change, but based on the investigation to date, is not believed to be involved in violent or illegal activities. Pickering publicly declared that he has been under government surveillance and is mindful of his activities. I mean, you can dissect these paragraphs over and over and thoroughly to really try to see how they operate. Like, the last sentence, publicly declares he has been under government surveillance and is mindful of his activities. Wink, wink, if he didn't know he was being investigated, he'd be out there burning places down. Right? You can really get to see how they think when you analyze these documents. Whether or not me or anybody else is actually committing a crime is mostly irrelevant. They never had a real crime in this whole investigation. They're saying we were forming an eco-terrorist cell, and by the way, if anyone wants to form an eco-terrorist cell, do not do it by opening a high-profile radical bookstore. It's the dumbest idea that there has ever been floated, right? So that was not our plan. But regardless, whether you're committing a crime or not is irrelevant. What's relevant to the FBI is whether you're an important part of a movement that is succeeding at bringing about some kind of change. If you are, they'll find a reason or they'll make up a reason to investigate you. Whether or not they actually intend on actually ever prosecuting that investigation is another story. In the meantime, as long as they can justify an investigation, they're gathering intel that relates to other investigations that they have and coordinating and fighting against the entire movement, not just me, or not just Teresa and Nate and Burning Books, but the entire movement, and not just in Buffalo, but across the country, right? All of these investigations are linked and referenced over and over to each other. In previous investigations, and this is another kind of important thing to get, it's like you can really get an idea of what's going on here in this one paragraph. It should be noted that an interview is like in the movies where they're like, oh yeah, where were you on the night of so-and-so? That's the FBI's version of an interview, right? Where they ask you where you were, somehow question you directly about the crime that they're allegedly investigating. It should be noted that an interview was not conducted of Pickering. In previous investigations, Pickering was not cooperative with interviewers. And as I mentioned, they had many previous investigations, right? So much experience to base that on. Additionally, Pickering has used a possible FBI investigation against him to gain publicity in the local and national press. Therefore, we got permission to forego an interview, right? They're saying that because all the other times they tried to investigate me, I refused to talk to them. And because every time I find out a piece of information about the details that they're investigating me or proving that they're investigating me, I get publicity in the national and local news. And they don't like any of that, so they didn't even want to question me with the initial interview and the investigation. The formula that we use, and that I think is pretty solid, you know, in almost every situation, is public exposure, legal lawsuits, and not backing down. Right? The biggest part of that, those public exposure and legal lawsuits are really big and have saved us. Our legal team is amazing, and we're very blessed to have them. Also, I'm fortunate to have the experience dealing with media from running the press for the Earth Liberation Front, and you know, learn trial by fire, learning how to deal with them a little bit, and so then I could use that for this investigation as well. But the not backing down thing is key, and you can see that here. The worst thing that the government can do, the most powerful tool it has, is our own fear and our own hopelessness. They can watch us, and they can even throw us in jail, and they can even kill us at times, which they've done. But nothing quite works as well as just scaring everybody, right? Scaring everybody out of being active. And this idea that the FBI is following you around and taking your pictures, and they know every time you swipe your credit card, and they're photocopying your mail, and all the other things I just went through, a large part of that is intended to scare people. It's really important that we don't get scared. It's really important that we realize that they're doing that because we're powerful. They're doing that because our movements threaten change. And their basic motivation is to prevent change, right? To stop social change. And because we're actually pressuring it, the more people pressure it, the more they investigate, the more they put pressure on repressing you. And I also want to point out, very importantly, that what I went through, what I've gone through, is by no means the worst case scenario, right? I think that's very important to realize. These three friends of ours, Robert Seth Hayes, David Gilbert, Jalil Mutakim, are three of many political prisoners that exist right here in the United States of America.
Prisoners?
Political prisoners. right? Jaleel and Seth and David are people that our family is in close contact with. We've been visiting them for years. Jaleel and Seth are both from the Black Panther Party. They've been in prison for 45 years. David was with the SDS in the Weather Underground. He's been in prison for 35 years. These are wonderful people that that we're very close with. And Eliza is now passing out postcards for Leonard Peltier, who's another political prisoner who's rather well known. Leonard is trying to get President Obama to pardon him before Obama leaves office. So if you sign this postcard and put a stamp on it, you'll see you can try to encourage Obama to do that. Yeah. As unlikely as it might be, it's definitely worth a stamp. Leonard's been in prison for 40 years. He's part of the American Indian Movement. Political prisoners in the U.S., whether or not they've committed crimes, they're certainly a lot more akin to Robin Hood than they are to any criminal in the minds of people like everyone sitting in this room, I'm assuming. These are people who've taken risks to further our movement and are now paying the price tenfold. You know, so it's really important for us to do what we can to support political prisoners. There's a calendar back there. Certain days, 2017, that is all about political prisoners. So if you want to check that out, it's a great thing to have on your wall throughout the year to remind you not just about political prisoners, but about other important movements in our history for social change in the U.S. It's a really cool thing. But these people are locked up in prison. There's other people like Asada Shakur, who's also a Black Panther Party, who was framed up on charges, finally convicted, even though she beat 7 or 8 of them, was finally convicted of one of them, and then was sentenced to an astronomical amount of time period. But then including people that Seth were working with busted her out of prison, and they ferried her to Cuba. And now she's living in exile in Cuba. She's the only female on the FBI's most wanted terrorist list, and they have a $2 million bounty on her head. She's been in Cuba since, I think, 1976, around there, if I'm not mistaken. There's Fred Hampton. Fred Hampton was the leader of the Chicago chapter of the Black Panther Party, and the FBI targeted him and was very concerned he was going to be the next, quote, black messiah, like Malcolm X, because he was good at giving speeches, and he was a good leader, right? They sent informants into the Chicago chapter of the Black Panther Party, and one of them rose up to be the right-hand man, the bodyguard of Fred Hampton. And he supplied the FBI a floor plan of Fred Hampton's apartment, and he slipped a sedative into Fred Hampton's meal that night. The FBI then supplied the Chicago police with that floor plan, and also with a bunch of false information about the Panthers stockpiling illegal weapons. Chicago police raided using a submachine gun and shot hundreds of rounds into the house, killing 2 people, Fred Hampton and Mark Clark, another Panther. There were no illegal weapons, and Hampton never even got out of bed. He was sedated in bed. He had been shot. They then went into the room after they pulled his pregnant wife out of the bed. They then went back into the room and said, he's still breathing. Fired a couple more shots at point blank range and said he's good and dead now. These things happen. You know, what I've gone through, what our family has gone through, is relatively minor, and especially in the global scheme of repression, right? You've got environmentalists in South America who are just slaughtered in shallow graves somewhere right now. But no matter what they do, as Fred Hampton has said in a speech shortly before he died, they can kill revolutionaries, but they cannot kill the revolution. Fred Hampton is still with us. Asada Shakur is a living inspiration in Cuba right now. These 3 men and the other dozens of political prisoners that are in the U.S. are still active in our movements, and we're still here, right? They launched this 2-year investigation into burning books, trying to basically just shut down our bookstore. That's really what they're trying to do. Shut down our bookstore. They didn't like the fact that we had a radical bookstore in Buffalo that was popular. You know, that the newspapers were reporting on positively, that people were going out to events several times a month at. That was not acceptable to them. So they launched this investigation trying to frame us up as a front to form a terrorist cell. Right? And they failed. You know, so far, knock on wood, you know, we're still free. The bookstore is still here. We have a little table set up in back. You know, we're doing a little bit better every year, and we're still fighting. The FBI, when we look at me in particular, the FBI has been investigating me for 20 years, since 1996. All of the files that I have, the FBI has admitted to having 30,000 plus pages on me. So far, I have 0.2% of those pages due to our lawsuits. They're supposed to be processing the rest of it, taking a long time. So I have a little over 600 pages out of 30,000. And among those 600 pages alone, just out of that 0.2%, there are over 42 investigations that I'm subjected to, right? And I'm still here. You know, there's nothing phenomenal about me. You know, I'm just an activist who's stubborn enough to keep trying and not giving up. And there's many of us out there. There's nothing extraordinary about me or about what we're doing. What's extraordinary is the will of the people to fight against repression. And the thing that is most important of all is that you don't look at this kind of thing and think, oh God, if I'm an activist, they're going to start watching me. You know, what you need to see is that, you know what, they're watching us because we're powerful. Because actually, maybe we have a better chance at winning this thing than we ever thought we did. There's all these moments throughout history where people actually believe that they can win, right? These groups bubble up, these movements bubble up here and there, and they fight like they can actually win every so often. And those are the most terrifying moments to the system, because they know that they are a tiny, tiny minority. And the moment we wake up and realize that together we have the strength to shut them down immediately, whenever we want, that's the end for them. So that's the important lesson here, is that, you know, they're doing all this stuff, spending probably millions of dollars just on watching me. And why do they do that? Because we can stop them and we can win. So thanks a lot.
Mm-hmm. Very interesting. I agree with what you said. I once got my own FBI files for the Freedom of Information Act.
Yes.
It's been a while, though. Didn't get any good pictures, unfortunately. Just a lot of redacted pages.
Did you sue?
No, I didn't. And when I hear it, it's now become harder after 9/11 that you basically have to sue.
You can't just fill
out a form and send it off, right?
You basically have to sue. There's a $450 filing fee, I believe, at this point. Then there might be attorney fees depending on your attorney if you have one. You basically have to sue, especially if it's a recent investigation. They're not going to give up any recent stuff.
I still think all radical activists should try to get what they can get through the Freedom
Some people feel.
So that we can put together a picture of what's going on here. That's the bigger question here that I've got is from the evidence you acquired from the Freedom of Information Act and other piecing other things together. Do you think that the FBI's harassment of you there for a couple of years was just a continuation of the investigation of the Earth Liberation Front, or was it a part of a bigger COINTELPRO program that's going on now in this time period against the radical left?
It's definitely bigger than just us, and it's definitely bigger than just the investigation in the Earth Liberation Front. It is a bigger COINTELPRO-esque sort of thing that's going on.
So what evidence do you see of that?
They use very broad terms and very broad language and link tons of investigations together. So anarchist is a big thing that they've been looking into for a while. So anything associated with anarchism, you'll see it cross-listed all the time with ELF stuff, and cross-listed all the time with my stuff. And tons of my files are on this case, the Shack case, the Stop Huntington Animal Cruelty case. That was a big investigation they had in the early 2000s. I had no involvement in the Shack campaign or the case there, but these people were friends of mine. But that was the extent of it. But they still have me doing all this stuff, putting stickers on buildings, stuff I never did for the Shack campaign. They've got me teaching how to make bombs in Kentucky. I've never been to Kentucky. They got me 5'6" with red hair in Oregon, years after I moved away from Oregon. It's just, a lot of it is just madness. It's just a really broad brush that they use. And so you can really see that these investigations are very often not meant to lead to specific indictments. You know, like this one in particular. This was really probably never going to go anywhere. But they were hoping it could keep running this investigation and keep gathering intelligence, which would then help them in future investigations. And many of the investigations are running simultaneously. So I've got time periods where there's more than one investigation that I'm under. So you can see it's much more of a general surveillance state scenario than it is, you know, like we think this person did this crime and that's all that we're looking at. They're never just looking at that. And that's not what the FBI was formed. That's not what J. Edgar Hoover formed the FBI to do. He formed them to be the Gestapo of the U.S. And that's really their, you know, unofficial role. So,
sure,
yes, it's very much COINTELPRO-esque. They had to stop using that term after the Church Committee hearings, but there's unanimous sort of, you know, sentiment out there that they still do engage in that type of general investigative activity.
I'm interested in what you're doing at the recess. You touched on it a little bit, but
okay.
Kind of what you were doing, what y'all together were doing, and what you're doing.
So, you know, we had gotten to be these, we had gotten really radical. Me and this guy, Craig, who ran the press office for the ELF, and, you know, we supported the Earth Liberation Fund and other radical activity, and we had gotten pretty far evolved along that line of activism. But at the same time, we were really getting interested in other issues besides environmentalism. We're getting turned on to all these other movements that had fought the ways that we were fighting before. We learned about the Weather Underground, George Jackson Brigade, United Freedom Front, all these other groups, you know, that were fighting even something as simple as the IRA or the Underground Railroad were things that were really interesting to us. So we wanted to try to figure out how we could build a movement that wasn't just fighting hard for the environment, but that was more oriented towards bringing about revolutionary change, right? But we felt like at the time, we felt like, you know, people weren't ready. Like, you know, everyone was in their own single-issue silo. I'm an animal rights activist. I'm a feminist. And this is what I care about, right? There was no intersectionality, as they say now, between these movements. There were very little that I could see at the time. So we wanted to build intersectionality while remaining really radical. But we also were, you know, we were doing into public education. I mean, you don't really think of it that way when you look at what the ELF press office did. But really, that's all we did. Like, we put out videos, we put out magazines and booklets and zines and pamphlets and spoke to the press and spoke at lectures. It's all just education and outreach. So that was our skill set. So really, we tried to combine that skill set with community organizing, which was we also had some experience in. And so, but under a broader, more revolutionary theme. We weren't just looking at the environment anymore. Now we were interested in the On the Lord's Party. We're interested in the Black Panther Party and what they had done. Interested in anti-nuclear activism in the 80s and what was going on there. Interested in stuff that was going on in Germany in the 60s and 70s and looking at that too. So trying to build a revolutionary consciousness was what our objective was. How we, this lofty goal and how we went about achieving that was, you know, in Buffalo, you saw what we did. We had these meetings, we did this survey. And, you know, I think it really worked. It really went a long way. It's not something that you can see a tangible, immediate result, like you can with ELF-style activity, but I think it was very important work. And in Oregon, they had another chapter of the same organization, and they did a lot of anti-police brutality organizing because there were police killings of unarmed African-Americans in Oregon at the time. So it was a big multiracial anti-police brutality, police violence thing that was going on in the early 2000s in Portland, Oregon at the time too. But around the same time, it all just crumbled. You know, it was just hard work. And when that repression that I detailed came down, we felt like we needed to take a step back and figure out a better way to do it. And now we're doing the bookstore, which in my mind, again, is the same thing as the press office. Like, we may not be getting communiques from the underground right now, but we've got books up there that have all those communiques printed in them, right? And we go around raising public education and awareness on people's movements. They don't want you to know about this stuff. Because if you know about it, you might actually realize that people have a chance to fight and win. So that was the idea, giving people the, you know, the impression that we can actually win. This is how people have fought and had victories before. So, does that answer your question?
Not really.
Not really.
I was more interested in like I see a lot of people doing radical popular education, and that it's very like leadership driven, or like that there's a group of people who are like. I was wondering more how you organize.
Okay. Yeah, we avoided media because I had a lot of bad experiences dealing with media for the ELF. Obviously, they're really excited to do a story on a building burning down. They're very unlikely to be sympathetic in that case. Just about as unlikely as you can get, you know, because the company that got burned down is most likely one of their contributors, you know, to the advertising budget, which feeds their salaries. So they're just really not going to be sympathetic towards you. So we had a lot of bad experiences with the press, and we were really trying to do this grassroots community-oriented thing. So we hung posters on poles, right? We would go to public events from time to time and hand out leaflets and flyers for our events. We engaged in other things that were going on in the community that were not inherently revolutionary, maybe not even radical, but were aligned with the kind of thinking that we were working on in a general sense. You know, got involved in this effort to stop the closure of these libraries, these 19 libraries. That was a big deal for us. And took a step back and put ourselves in the tried to put ourselves in the position of where average everyday people in our community were to then help bring that whole community up, instead of just being like, well, I've read this, and I've read that, and I've done this, and I've done that, so here I am, ready to fight. You know, we say, you know what, I'm all alone here, ready to fight, so that's not a good place to be. So we went back and really tried to community organize. It's hard, and we weren't trying to be like big talking heads, or trying to be leaders, and we weren't organizing demonstrations in the streets. All we did was education. We were trying to empower people to become their own leaders and to start their own movements, you know, rather than putting all of our energy into starting one campaign and seeing if we can fight and save those cats. You know, we thought that we would try to spawn 100 campaigns that other people would do and serve as a support base for them, which is what we do with the bookstore now. And we open the space up that the Standing Rock organizing is all going out. Coming out of the bookstore locally, and you know, Occupy Buffalo was heavily involved there. So it's a base, it's an institutional foundation that helps progressive and radical organizing in our community exist. You know, so maybe that answers your question a little bit better. Yeah, it's hard to do that kind of work, but I think it's important. You know, working with people is an important thing. And you know, running a business isn't really our forte. You know, it's not like we have a lot of experience. A lot of the work we do is really mundane. To keep the place open, to keep it so that there's a place for people to come and organize and work out of. If they want to learn about what's going on in the past with Native American indigenous resistance, they know they can come to Burning Books and get stuff on the American Indian Movement and on Crazy Horse, you know, or whatever. So we feel like that's an important part of the overall movement. It might not be the most glamorous, but...
Yeah. I think what you were talking about in terms of, like, top-down, like, in ERISA and also with Burning Books, it's not as... Like, nobody is telling anybody what to do. You know, there's a place where people can come and share ideas and learn about past movements. And I think that's been effective so far, just having a space where people can share ideas. And, you know, that was a critique, particularly about ERISA, was that people would learn things and they would be excited to do something, and then, like, where can people put their energy? And if anything, that was maybe something that could have used more direction, but... I think that, you know, that the learning process and the understanding of what was happening was really what we were pushing, the educational piece.
I think another sort of unwritten thing that we had been doing during ERISA and afterwards, you know, like with my experience with the ELF press office, we became very isolated. We were the most radical people in the community. Not only did we think that about ourselves, unfortunately, but everyone else seemed to think that about us too. They didn't want to come around us because the FBI are watching us, because those people I think they're so great. Or like, you know, the ELF on one night go out and set something on fire and these people get press, you know, out the ears because of it. And we've been running our campaign to save this forest or whatever for years and months and sitting out there in the trees through the winter and nobody wants to do a story on us. It, you know, we weren't effectively building healthy relationships with other people in the movement. We were becoming isolated radicals. And I saw the negative outcome of that over and over again. And so, you know, in Buffalo, coming back to my hometown and working with new people was an opportunity to learn from those mistakes. We built relationships with everybody we could, including journalists, including lawyers, including just everyday people who were working on issues. Maybe they were, you know, people who had strict beliefs in nonviolence, which I don't agree with strictly. You know, but didn't matter. The Peace Center, all these other people out there that in, back in Oregon, I would have been like, those people don't know what they're talking about. You know, now they're our allies, and we see, we understand where they're coming from, and they understand where we're coming from. And so then, when the FBI comes to attack any of us, we're all together, and the press are friends of ours a lot of times, and they'll report positively, and we have a crew of lawyers that will come and defend us. Because we're not falling into that, we're trying not to fall into that trap of like, my thinking is better than yours, I'm more radical than you, I've got the right idea, I've got the right political line. We're working as a community recognizing that if any of us had the right political line, we would have won this revolution a long time ago. So, you know, we're working on it from the ground up with people in the community and trying to unite instead of be the top, you know, climb, because that, maybe if that makes sense too. Again, it's slower, you know, but I think it's important, and it's what saved us in this case. Brian?
I think you were
first. Go ahead.
Yeah. I've been praying for Leonard Felt here.
Yes.
Since it happened.
Yes.
Every day. And I believe in prayer. And I hope we all pray all the time for this man. Mm-hmm. So it's so wonderful, you know, for the lady who died. It's so terrible.
Anime. Yeah. Anime, I thought.
Anime.
Yeah.
Terrible thing. Mm-hmm. And so I was surprised to be here and that had this intense thing. This is, and this is not outrageous or whatever you might say. This is what you have to do. Mm-hmm. And I thank you so much, very much for this.
Well, thanks for coming out. Brian?
Yeah. If you look at the limited amount of coverage that there is of the FBI and their activities, the sense you get is that they're overwhelmed with following the Muslim community and that the level of harassment there is far beyond, of even people who aren't political at all, is far beyond anything those of us on the left have experienced. And you get the impression that the FBI doesn't currently commit a lot of resources to looking at domestic activists. Were you at all surprised that, or to what extent were you surprised that the FBI was committing that level of resources to following you around? And what lessons do you draw about what the FBI's priorities actually are today?
I can answer that question, the surprise question, in a few different ways. So it's really hard to think what way I want to answer it.
Yeah.
Part of me says I wasn't at all surprised, especially with the history. I wasn't raided by the FBI during this investigation. I have been raided twice in the past.
Right.
Right. Nobody was actually subpoenaed to a federal grand jury before. That happened 7 times in the past. In some ways, I was like, yeah, this is what I assumed the FBI has always been doing. I even heard that there was an FBI incident at Goddard at one point. And so it's like, you know, there's a lot of stuff that I heard along the way or picked up or assumed, you know, that this stuff had happened. And it was pretty clear to me that the FBI had, you know, not forgotten about me, to say the least. The extent to which that they were interested in burning books was somewhat surprising still. Because part of, you know, you get to think the way that they do. You know, all the TV reflects the way that they think. All the media reflects the way that they think most of the time. You start to think, well, you know what? These buildings did burn down, and I did go on TV saying, go dad, you know. They're going to watch me. You know, you start to think that you've done something wrong or that you deserve it on some level. And it's hard to beat that back. You know, many friends in prison for doing Earth Liberation Front stuff and other similar things. You know, friends have been in prison for, that I organized with, you know, worked with and close with, have been in prison for things that were illegal and things that really weren't illegal and went to prison anyway. Like the Shaq case, the Shaq 7 case. You know, they ran a website. They spoke out publicly and they went to prison. So if they could go to prison, what I did with the ELF was way more extensive than what the Shaq people did around the Shaq case, and they all went to prison, seven or six of them did, you know, for between 3 and 5 years. So if they can go to prison for that, well, I better watch my back, you know. So these ideas are all in there somewhere, and you gotta fight to stay above that type of thinking all the time. So it's a mix of being surprised and not being surprised. A lot of the way I look at it is like, this stuff is powerful that I'm getting in my hands right now through the Freedom of Information Act. Images of our family in parking lots, you know, taken by the FBI. It has the potential to interest people and awaken them up to the reality, you know, and draw attention to this thing that I know is happening, whether or not we can see it. So the more that we can get, like, I'm actually kind of inclined to do things now that I might be able to use, mm-hmm. I might be able to get later on. Like, maybe I'll get an easy pass. This is one thought I had one day. You know what that is? It's like your car goes right through the toll booth.
Tracks everything.
Right. Maybe I'll get an easy pass, and then I'll use the statewide Freedom of Information Law to find out how they're tracking easy passes. You know? Maybe I'll try to apply for a pistol permit and see if they reject me. And on what basis are they rejecting me? Because I've never been convicted of a violent crime. All these kinds of things, like, go through my head a lot. You know, so that's the orientation I'm at mm-hmm. now. Try to get as much, let them survey me, and I'll see if I can figure out how it's happening, and then I'll try to use that to expose them. Like, that's my strategy now. Yeah.
Just a last comment on, you're being so honest about yourself and the evolution of your thinking, so it's wonderful to hear that. And certainly, one of the, I just want to underscore that one of the profound purposes of the repression of you is to, as you're saying, to drive other people underground and to divide the left or those who are opposed. And that has a long history going back. If there's someone I'm friends with whose father was a revolutionary and the FBI was after him for decades. Mm. And this person has chosen to be a Quaker chaplain. That's how she now does her work, given what she saw for decades. Mm. But she's a stalwart ally, but just needs to be from a different location to take care of herself. And so it's to say, we always need to try to find ways to connect with each other amid our tactical differences.
That was a big thing for me as a very young adult and getting radicalized very quickly and having some intense experiences as a young adult. I fell into the same trap that many other people have historically, and made a lot of mistakes, you know. I don't believe that speaking out publicly in support of the Earth Liberation Front was a mistake. I don't believe that what the Earth Liberation Front did was a mistake. But I do believe that when we start to get self-righteous about our activities and adapting our behavior and our relationships around this, like, idea that I'm better than everyone else or I'm doing something that's more important than what everyone else is doing, it's really dangerous. And I saw how that was dangerous. And there was a lot of division that happened within the environmental movement. You know, when we would do an article, there would be a big article on the Earth Liberation Front, they would quote us, and then of course they had to find somebody else to counter us, right? The FBI were always ready to make comments when it came to big stories, at least. But when they didn't have an FBI able to make a comment, or if that wasn't enough for the story, they would reach out to the Sierra Club most frequently. And the Sierra Club, very frequently, as you can see, on the back of my book on the Earth Liberation Front, was more than willing to make quotes saying that the Earth Liberation Front was the worst thing that had ever happened to the environmental movement, more or less, in different words, different times. And I saw that as destructive. Here we are working against all these odds to try to get an important message out in this medium that is just almost impossible to get any real message out, period. And to add on to that we now have to be arguing against our own allies, in theory, to this was, it's I saw the power of dividing and conquering that way. And I think that it increasingly sunk in and helped me change my attitude. Also, coming to Goddard was a big thing. As I said, we were very isolated in Portland. I worked with a very small group of people who were all ready to go to prison or worse for what we were doing, and we didn't trust anybody except for our small crew. And coming to Goddard really opened me up. You know, I met people of different ages, different time periods. Also, Oregon's like very white, and the people out there at the time were very much of my demographic, young environmental radicals. And coming here, I saw people from different movements, people from New York City, people, you know, and I was like, yeah, you know what, this is what home in Buffalo was like. More diverse, maybe, but still, like, along the same lines, except that these people were all part of the movement. And I realized at that point that people who were writing books and doing studies on different things were making valuable contributions, because I spent a week with them, or 8 days, or whatever it was, at residency, and I saw, I got to know them as people, and it wasn't just like, I saw their project and criticized it, like I would have years before. You know, I saw the project, I sat in circles with them, discussing how they could better their project, how I could better my project. And, you know, that was important. I think that when you isolate yourself, it was a big lesson for me. You isolate yourself, you know, when you build a wall, I've been telling my daughter, because there's a lot of wall building talk going on these days, when you build a wall, there are two sides to it. You know, there's the people who can't get in, there's also the people who can't get out. And, you know, we're building walls around ourselves. I was building walls around myself. And I think that it's important to not do that, and at the same time to not be any less radical. Like, I'm not trying to be any less radical. I support radical activity. I'm not trying to look like I'm a peacenik now. I'm not. I'm not. David Gilbert is doing 75 to life. People died in the incident that he came from. Seth Hayes and Julio Muntu came a part of the Black Liberation Army. You know, they were retaliating against police who had killed Black Panthers. So, you know, police had killed 30 some odd Black Panther Party members, and the BLA decided that they would, that they wouldn't be the only ones that would suffer, and ambushed police officers and killed some. I mean, that's what they decided. I wasn't there. I wasn't Black. It wasn't my people who were being killed. Who am I to judge? I've decided to go in and meet these people. I'm no less radical. I'm perhaps more radical, actually, now than I was back then. And I think that there are FBI files that I didn't show that specifically show that my generation of radical environmentalists hooking up with 60s and 70s era revolutionaries is a huge concern among the FBI. They monitored specific conferences, in particularly this Break the Chains conference in 2003 in Oregon, where people from the George Jackson Brigade and the resistance conspiracy and trying to think who else, but there were all American Indian movement, there were all these movement elders there who were engaged in armed struggle. And they were meeting up with all these radical environmentalists. And the FBI were very specific in that document, saying that they were afraid of the influence, they were afraid of mentorship. You know, and why are they afraid? Because it threatens them, it threatens the system. So breaking down walls between movements and people within the movement is important. You know, dividing and conquering is so powerful against us. And in my mind, you know, if you're only comfortable with organizing potlucks and anything more radical than that is a problem, well, you know what? Can I come to your potluck? Because I like potlucks too. You know, so it's not like I'm going to try to push you to do something more radical, but I will try to talk to you about understanding where other people are coming from, too.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Thanks
a lot. Mm-hmm. If anyone else has any questions, we'll be back at the table. God bless America.
Thank you.
Yes, that's right.